All right, we are back here on the Just End the Suffering podcast. We're talking New York Yankees baseball, and I feel like their fans are having some suffering right now. It's uncharacteristic for them. Join me today, the guy who covers them for MLB.com, Brian Hoke, is on the line. Brian, how are you?
I'm doing great. How are you?
Doing pretty good. I have to say, going into the season, I mean, with World Series expectations for the Yankees, pressure was really high. How shocking is it to be sitting here mid-June recording before they start the Toronto series that they're 33-32 in fourth place?
Never what I expected. And I think that, you know, I was in spring training the whole time I watched this team. It didn't even cross my mind that they were going to have trouble scoring runs. I didn't think that that was going to be the issue. I had legitimate questions about the state of their starting rotation behind Gerrit Cole. And really, the pitching has been pretty good. The pitching has not been the issue. They carried them for a period of time where they had that hot stretch in May. But this team has just been consistently inconsistent. They have not put enough runs on the board, and they're in a very tough division where you mentioned Toronto, but they're chasing Tampa Bay. They're chasing Boston, who has been better than I expected. I did not forecast 33-32 fourth place after 65 games. I definitely did not see this one coming.
Yeah, I have to say, it was definitely interesting over the weekend because I saw your question, Aaron Boone, got him very upset when you asked about whether this team was a little bit too accepting of the losing and stuff like that. What did you think about that, his response to your question?
You know, now that I've had some time to think about it, that's exactly what you want your manager to respond. I think that was probably the appropriate response, and I think Yankee fans appreciate seeing some fire from their manager because so many of these Zoom press conferences have just been the same old rigmarole of, we're getting there. We're going to turn the corner. We're getting close. I'm seeing some good signs. And it's like, all right, but you've lost 11 out of 15. So, you know, where are these good signs taking you? And I think that, it certainly got me some attention. It went viral. That wasn't my intent with the question, but I guess that maybe it's the new Savages in the Box rallying cry. And if so, if the team turns it around and they go to the World Series after this, maybe they'll cut me a playoff share or something.
Hey, maybe they can send you a ring if that ends up working out.
There you go, right?
Yeah. I mean, I have to say, watching this team from afar, and I think the interesting comparison, I don't think it's been made yet, is I feel like there are a lot of comparisons between the Yankees and the Nationals where they have a roster on paper that looks very good. They have a couple of players who are top-notch. If you're going to send three guys to the All-Star game, then you have a bunch of names saying, you know what, like, why aren't they performing up to their ability? And this, we see what the Nationals have done this year. They've been pretty bad. Do you think there's a similarity here to what the Yankees have going on, what's going on in Washington?
Yeah, I think that you can definitely make that parallel. A lot of teams around where, I mean, offense is across the board, and that brings us into the whole discussion about sticky stuff, and it looks like baseball is going to crack down on that, and I am curious to see if that hit the way you would think, but by and large, the average just not performing like great this year, and I don't know if it's the hangover effect from the shortened season with the pandemic or if it is the sticky stuff. I think there's probably a lot of things going on, which is why the product, honestly, has been kind of boring. It's been a lot of walk, strikeout, home run, and the three true outcomes. I don't think that that's the best way for baseball. I like seeing guys run around the bases, and hopefully we can get back to more of that.
It's like running the bases a problem for the Yankees. I feel like they're not a good fundamental team. I can't remember a team that I've seen makes many outs on the bases they do.
It really is mind-blowing because the fundamentals are not there. And that part of is why I think I may have asked that question there about a team getting used to losing. Because, look, I covered a lot of Met teams back in the early 2000s that you knew the season was over by July. And you started to see that in their body language, kind of the slumped shoulders. And I don't want to say I'm seeing that with the Yankees right now, but what I'm seeing is a kind of lack of situational awareness. And the amount of times that I've seen a runner at second with a ball hit in front of him, I mean, that's a little league play. You do not advance on that ball. And I've seen Gary Sanchez do it, and we saw Ronald Odor do it. The Yankees have made 31 outs on the base pass this year. They've also hit into the most double plays of any team. And, you could say that's a product of having a lot of guys on, but that means they've given away about 90-something outs on the base pass this year, and no wonder they're having trouble scoring runs. And so you know, I don't think you can kill them too much for the double plays, but you can kill them for the outs on the base pass, especially when it's just not knowing what the situation calls for. I've seen Clint Frazier overthrow the cutoff man too many times. You know, I just see guys airmailing throws and making errors, and you know, the physical errors you'll miss, you'll deal with. If Gleyber Torres boots a ground ball, there's not a whole lot you can do about it. It's the making throws that don't need to be made and making outs on the base pass that don't need to be made that really drive you crazy.
Yeah, I mean, I'm a fan myself. I feel like if Keith Hernandez was on the Yankee broadcast, he might have had a stroke by this point.
I remember certain days, one of these Met teams I'm talking about where Keith kind of was a little too open and honest on SNY, and he actually had to go down in the clubhouse at Shea Stadium and apologize to the players because he was ripping them on the air. And I remember Mike Piazza said something like voices from the grave, man, like about Keith Hernandez criticizing the Mets. But he was right. He was dead on, and he shouldn't have had to apologize because that Met team was fundamentally not sound. And, you know, I think that more than anything falls on Aaron Boone and the coaching staff in not having these guys mentally prepared to play these games.
Yeah, I think that's something worth watching here, because I know this Yankee team, the thing that also surprised you that, as you said, for the most part, it seems to be a lot of coming rhetoric prior to your question over the weekend. It was a lot of like, oh, we're going to be fine, small sample size, like just back to the baseball card, guys are turning things around. Like, you surprised in general by the sort of lack of urgency from the front office in particular to try and like shake things up a little bit?
Kind of, yeah. I mean, they've made a couple of smaller moves here. You bring in a guy like Odor, and I think that if I'm Brian Cashman, I need to go trade for a center fielder. If you're serious about making a run toward the postseason, you cannot be running Brett Gardner out there for 130, 140 games. That was not the idea in bringing him back. He was supposed to be a fourth or fifth outfielder, a guy who would come in off the bench and play some defense and pinch run and, you know, get a start or two a week. And, you know, he's 37 going on 38. It's just not fair side of Guardy at this point. And this rotating revolving door of Gardner and Aaron Judge in center field and Tyler Wade, I mean, it's a Band-Aid solution. I mean, they need to figure out something there because they've gotten almost no production from center field. They've gotten very little from first base. Now, Luke Voit is coming back. Maybe if he's the guy who was the Major League home run leader last year, maybe that would certainly help the offense. But so trade for a center fielder. And I think that, you know, you were counting on Luis Severino coming back, but now that it looks like it's going to be longer than you thought, I think they have to trade for a starting pitcher too, because nobody knows when Corey Kluber is coming back. That is very spotty as well. And the rest of the rotation behind Gerrit Cole and Domingo Germán has been very shaky.
The thing I don't understand also, I know the center field thing is a big problem, is like Esteban Floreal down in the minors. I mean, he sits the kind of profile of the player they need, where he plays good defense, he has some speed. I get that they don't want to rush him to the big leagues, but I mean, back in 2005, nobody thought Robinson Cano was ready for the big leagues. He can't make a big impact. And you can make the argument that bringing Floreal up right now would help the defense, give them a little speed, give them a little life, shake things up a little bit. Do you have any suspicions why they're not going that direction?
I think it's just the underperformance that he's had at AAA. You know, I'm looking it up right now, and he's hitting 171 at AAA. So he really hasn't performed that well. And, you know, you draw the comparison with Cano, he was tearing it up down there. And so, yeah, he was ahead of schedule, and they have brought Floreal up at times, but I think that they just don't think he's capable of handling this offensively on an everyday basis. So I'm not opposed to bringing him up and giving him a shot to see if you can catch lightning in a bottle there, but I think that the performance that he's shown in the minor leagues thus far shows that he's not ready. So if they thought he was ready, I think he'd be here already.
Yeah, that's a fair point. I also think the pitching is worth watching, especially the sticky stuff situation hanging around Gerrit Cole. That's going to be a distraction they really don't need right now, especially in the light of that SI report that came out about how he's sending text messages to that former employee of the Angels getting these substances. So I know the Yankees didn't pay $324 million for Gerrit Cole to have, like, be sort of go back to what he had for the Pirates. I think it's a little overblown. At the same time, you got to be sitting there wondering, like, how much of this is impacting what he did for Houston?
Yeah, I will never know. I mean, we'll never know. But what we do know is that magically his spin rates did increase a lot going from Pittsburgh to Houston. And he did become one of the best pitchers in the game. And I think that sticky stuff or no sticky stuff, he is one of the best pitchers in the game. But I think that it probably took him to an otherworldly level where he was, you know, in the Cy Young conversation. And I am curious to see how he handles this. He answered it pretty well after with his actions. He did not answer it well in the Zoom room, but he did when he went on the mound, and he did shove for an outing there. He needs to continue to do that. And, you know, I think that if you see a massive performance drop off, then that's going to be a smoking gun to a lot of people. So, you know, Gerrit Cole just needs to continue to go out and pitch the way he has been. You know, he started the year, he was on fire. He's setting strikeout records in franchise history. And I was thinking, you know, Ron Guidry's 18 strikeout game is not going to last a year. So maybe Guidry is safe now. And he can rest easy there that 18 strikeout game will go. But I think that Gerrit Cole is the kind of guy that no matter what, every time he's on the mound, you think there's a chance he might throw a no-hitter that day.
Yeah, I mean, he's the least of their problem because the rest of that rotation, I mean, going into the season, I said this sort of reminded me of the 2020 Met rotation where it had like one sure thing and a bunch of question marks. That fell apart in the Mets and the Yankees. I mean, Cole's in great for the most part. Kluber was good before he got hurt, but then you have Jameson Taillon and Domingo Germán been inconsistent. Jordan Montgomery is what he is. I mean, is there a worry if you're a Yankee fan that the pitching that's been carrying that for 2 months is going to start sort of collapsing a little bit?
Well, that I think would be my concern is that the starting pitching has carried them for a period of time, and if that is going to fall off, Taillon has been inconsistent. Germán has actually been one of their better starters. Montgomery's been up and down. But if these guys start to fall off a little bit, and by the way, none of us know how pitchers, especially starting pitchers, are going to deal with the fact that they didn't throw a complete season last year. Nobody made 32 starts last year because you couldn't. And so I do expect that there will be some kind of second half fatigue or fall off in these guys. And when that starts to happen, that domino effect across the league, I think you're going to have to lean on your bullpen a lot heavier. And look, the Yankees have one of the American League's stronger bullpens. It got a little stronger with bringing Zach Britton back, but you've seen it as much as anybody. When you tax these bullpens day after day after day, the performance starts to go down. And so I think that it could be a domino effect, not just with the Yankees, but with teams around the majors where their starters are going to get a little tired here. You know, the Yankees weren't counting on 200 innings from anyone except maybe Cole, and that was a pretty maybe. So you're going to have to be filtering guys in and out there, making spot starters. And I think that run production could go up in the second half just based upon that alone.
Yeah, one of the keys to the run production is Giancarlo Stanton. The Yankee fans, I know he's sort of become a punching bag for them because he's always hurt. And he had this stretch when he came off the injury, so he sat in 3 of 6 games. It was a bit frustrating. I feel like for the Yankees, like a lot of their current situation, I think, comes down to the fact that they got Stanton. They took on the contract, and it's sort of whether they want to admit or not, hamstrung them making other moves that could have helped the team other places. Like, what do you think they can get out of Stan the rest of this year? Because I feel like he's got to be a big factor that they're going to turn this around.
Yeah, I think that you just hope that you don't play in any more National League ballparks, for example. You know, he was starting to heat it up a little bit. He was swinging the bat good, and during the Minnesota series, he had 3 homers in the last 2 games, and then they went to Philadelphia, and because they don't trust his body to play the outfield, he was limited to just pinch hitting duty for 2 games, and so they'll get him back in the lineup tonight. He can play in the Salem Field series up in Buffalo, but I think that you're really not counting on him to play much in the field at all. And I know that Boone said it's something they'll revisit, but I think that his best way of contributing to this Yankee team is to just, you know, be the guy who hits a homer every night and to be that DH, be that dangerous presence in the lineup. Because when, you know, he really is one of the most, you know, Boone called him a unicorn, and he's right. He's just different than any other player. He's got this weird swing where it looks like he's not swinging at all with his lower half. It's all arms, it looks like. You would definitely not teach this swing to a little leaguer. But when he barrels it up, it goes 500 feet, and it's just remarkable. He's an incredible athlete. The question has been keeping him on the field, and we know that the performance is there. We saw him win the MVP when he was with Miami. It's just, can you get him in that lineup for 400, 500 at-bats? And that's what they have to do. They have to cross their fingers and pray that you can keep Stanton and Judge, those two big guys, healthy in the lineup as often as possible. And there was a great stat about a week ago where in games where Judge and Stanton both homer, the Yankees are undefeated. They're 10-0, including the postseason. So that's the formula right there. Get Judge and Stanton to hit home runs in the same game, and the Yankees will win a lot of games.
Yeah, it makes a lot of sense. And the one thing I'm keeping track of with them is obviously they're in a spot where they really need to turn around soon. And the AL, there's only five playoff berths. There's not eight. So there's not like a safety cushion for them to sort of fall out and just get in anyway. So part of me wonders that like if this team is not picking up and they're sitting there in late July, they're struggling, they're a decent amount back of the wild card spot. Do you think there's any scenario where this team could sell? Because honestly, look at the roster. I don't know how much they could actually could sell. It's not a lot there that would be really attractive to other teams.
No, yeah, I think that you could see possibly a situation kind of like what the Yankees went through in, it was 2015, I believe, or 2016, where it was kind of a half-in, half-out rebuild, and that was how they wound up getting Gleyber Torres from the Cubs by trading Aroldis Chapman. And so, you know, they were kind of unloading some of those older pieces, you know, the Carlos Beltrans and trying to rebuild on the fly without actually saying they were rebuilding. And so I could see that potentially happening, but as far as a full-scale teardown of everything, no, I doubt that the Yankees could do that because, you know, bottom line, this team needs to continue to sell tickets. We got fans back in the ballpark now. They're about to be full capacity again. And look, after a year of playing in empty ballparks, the Yankees don't want to be drawing 12,000 people in September. So they need to have a competitive product on the field. And really, it's incumbent on the guys on this roster to turn it around because, yeah, like we said, Cashman could probably trade for one or two pieces. You can get a starting pitcher or a center fielder, but you can't trade the entire team. And so it's going to take all of these guys, the DJ LeMahieu's, the Gleyber Torres, Gary Sanchez, Judge, Stanton, they're going to have to play the way we expected them to play back in spring training, or otherwise this team's not going to go anywhere.
Yeah, obviously. I feel like the question, the follow-up obviously would be, like, if this group, which has sort of plateaued after 17, or they made it to the ALCS, they had the surprise run, they have not gone farther since then, and if this group ends up missing the playoffs entirely, like, how high are the seats for Aaron Boone and Brian Cashman?
Yeah, I've been asked that a lot. And I, you know, people keep asking me if Boone is on the hot seat, and I keep saying he's on a warm seat because, Cashman has never fired a manager or a coach in season during his tenure, which goes all the way back to 1998. Now, the Yankees have had a lot of winning seasons during that time period, so there was no reason that they were going to fire a manager in season, but it's just not something the Yankees have done, and I don't think that Hal Steinbrenner wants to pay Aaron Boone while he brings in, say, Buck Showalter to manage the rest of the season. So I do think that Boone is going to get a chance to pull out of this tailspin, and the trick here is that Boone's contract is up after this year, and that's the tricky part because, look, Boone came in, he won 100 games back-to-back years, got the team to the playoffs his first couple of years. The pandemic year, I think you can throw that out the window in a lot of fashion here. But this is a team, 2021, that was supposed to go to the playoffs, win the World Series. And if they fall well short of that and don't even get there, then I think that seat becomes pretty hot, considering, look at the way the last two Yankee managers were dismissed. It was not a firing. It was Joe Torre was let go when his contract expired, and Joe Girardi. Same story. Could it be the same story for Aaron Boone? We're going to find out.
Yeah, we are going to find out. My last question is, obviously, this group as a whole, they've underachieved. I mean, if you want to include the record from the pandemic year to that, over their last hundreds or 120-something games, they are 66-59, which is not very encouraging overall, but, like, there's still a lot of baseball left. Do you think this group has a turnaround in it? Can they right the ship here and make that run to the playoffs we all expected them to?
I think they can. I don't know if they will. I think that the talent in that team is the reason why we were all picking them to win this division. Now, I think they've dug themselves a huge hole here. I don't know if they can catch Tampa Bay. You know, maybe Boston comes back down to earth a little bit here. Toronto, I don't think they're ready yet. You know, but they are a big pain in the neck for this Yankee team. They're so much younger and athletic than the Yankees. They play a different brand of baseball, and I expected that to continue this week here. So the Yankees really do have their work cut out for them. They have just spun their wheels for the first 65 games of the year. They've almost gotten nowhere. And, you know, this team really needs to get on one of those hot streaks where they're winning 8 out of 10 or 9 out of 15 or something like that to make up some ground here. Because, you know, otherwise, if they just keep treading water and playing 500, there's no chance. And, you know, Brett Gardner was saying it the other day, and I think he put it pretty well, was that, look, it is just the middle of June and there's a lot of season left, but every day that passes without a win is a missed opportunity. And that's how they need to look at it here. In that, yeah, you got a lot of time left, but you got to make up some ground. Otherwise, that clock is going to run out pretty quickly.
Yeah, for sure. We'll see how they go the rest of the way. Brian, thanks for all the time. I really appreciate it. Before I let you go, how can people follow social media keep up with your coverage of the Yankees for MLB.com?
Sure. It's I think, you know, follow me on Twitter at Brian Hoch, BryanHoch. On Instagram, same handle there. And my new book, The Bronx Zoom, is out now. That covers the 2020 pandemic season and the most bizarre season in Yankees baseball, Yankees history. So that's available on Amazon, Barnes & Noble, wherever books are sold.
Yeah, it sounds like a lot of fun. I'll definitely check that out, Brian. Thanks all the time. I appreciate it.
You got it, guys. Thank you. Take care.